Coming up on this edition of The Climate Show, we're off to Tuvalu and Tuvalu, where they've got a bad situation with water at the moment. But is it going to be a model for how the world should react to future climate change issues? And Gareth is back, goodness me.
I am. I'm back in New Zealand and I'm talking to the world. Wonderful. The Tuvalu thing is interesting because it leads us into a discussion about the El Nino Southern Oscillation and what might happen to that in the future. And we're also going to look at a fascinating discovery that there was so much rainfall in Brisbane last summer that it caused sea levels to drop.
Goodness me. Also, Ocean Calling with John Cook at Skeptical Science. That is all coming up on this edition of The Climate Show. This episode of The Climate Show is brought to you by hot-topic.co.nz, sideblogs.co.nz, skepticalscience.com, scoop.co.nz, idealog.co.nz, and KiwiFM. What good is a drop in the ocean? Hello and welcome along to The Climate Show. This is episode number 20, recording 18th of October 2011. It's a show all about climate science, news, policy and politics and solutions as well. My name is Glenn Williams at glennwilliams.co.nz, recording in Ponsonby, Auckland City. And I'm joined by my co-host. He's back finally after all his travels around the world. It's good to have him back. It's Gareth Renowden, of course, at hot-topic.co.nz. Hey, Gareth.
Hi, Glenn. Okay, can I just say and get it in now that I'm still feeling guilty for having been around the world on a high carbon transport. On the other hand, I'm not going to do it every day. So, yeah, I'm back. I'm not back in the swing of it, but things are beginning to happen.
So. You've been saving it up for years, though, haven't you? Years, literally, that travel. So it was well deserved, I think.
And we even sold 3 cases of our wine in London.
Oh, did you?
I'm very pleased.
Very good. Very well. Excellent. All right. Well, let's crack on with the show. First of all, don't forget that the show notes are up at theclimateshow.com and also hot-topic.co.nz. And there are 2 different forms of the show as well, video through the YouTube channel or an audio as well. And you can subscribe to those both on the website. But let's get on into the news. And there's certainly a lot of it. Of course, we will have John Cook over at Skeptical Science a little bit later on the show, debunking the skeptic, as he does. And he did a very good job co-hosting the show, I've got to say. Very, very nice to have John in there. But anyway, the news. First up, Tuvalu is having a spot of bother with water and the lack of it.
Yeah, this has been making headlines in New Zealand and actually around the world for at least the last 2 or 3 weeks since I got back to New Zealand. And it's an interesting way of looking at how climate impacts might be in the future. So let's just summarize briefly what's happening. These Pacific Islands, Tuvalu and Tokelau, are very low-lying. They're very freshwater resources, so the groundwater is extremely limited. And they get most of their drinking water from rainfall. Now, over the last year, we've been having one of the most intense La Nina events of the last 100 years, at least by some measures. And that tends to cause a drop-off in rainfall in this particular region of the Pacific. So these islands have gradually been running out of water, and there is not much prospect of immediate top-ups of rain. And so Tokelau and Tuvalu got to, I think, within a couple of days of having no fresh water at all, which, of course, would have been disastrous for the population. And so New Zealand and a number of other countries have been shipping in desalination equipment, bottled water and all sorts of things. There's a really good piece in The Guardian from Toby Manhire, which came out this morning. He's actually there and talks about some of the ways that people are coping with living on, in some cases, 40 litres of water a day, which is really not very much, particularly when you're dealing with, 30 plus degrees Celsius heat.
Apparently, it doesn't seem to matter how many people in your household, you are allocated exactly the same amount of water.
Yeah, that's right. It's a fairly brutal form of rationing, but I guess, you know, it's better that you get some water than that you get none. So, yeah, I think it's a real challenge for these islands, and it's interesting. One of my co-bloggers, Tom Bennion at Hot Topic, did a piece about it last week, and nobody is at this stage saying that this particular event has been caused by climate change. It's possible that it's been made worse by climate change, but what it is an interesting way. Is that you can actually see how all the various elements of impacts come together. So the islands are low-lying, they're threatened by sea level rise. Sea level rise will mean that the groundwater that exists on these islands will have seawater encroaching into it. So it'll become brackish and become less useful. And so that's one impact. Then you have the potential for strong La Nina events bringing these dry spells. And so you get a sort of interaction here of lots of different things, but all of which add up to a really dramatic human impact.
And would you say, I mean, as Toby says in his Gardening article here, he suggests that this is a bit of a dry run, as it were, you know, a kind of a micro version of what we could expect in other areas of the world in the future, and the response that the world community gives Tuvalu and Tukalau are a sort of a practice run in some ways.
Well, absolutely. What it does is it means that, you know, climate change is you're never going to be able to point to any one single event and say, well, that was caused by climate change, except possibly when we get, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 years into the future. But what we can say, just as we can with extreme weather events, the changing of the climate, the accumulation of heat in the system is making these events worse. And it's an additional factor which can act negatively on exposed populations. Now, the interesting thing is that as far as Tuvalu and Tokelau are concerned, the La Nina event, which seemed to be over during the Southern Hemisphere winter, Northern Hemisphere summer. The sort of indices that people use to measure the of these events had sort of tipped back up towards El Nino territory, but hadn't quite gone all the way there. Now it looks as though we're heading back into another spell of La Nina, and this will mean that the prospects for rain in this area are not going to be great, certainly over the next 3 or 4 months. For New Zealand, where we're broadcasting from, a La Nina spring and summer usually brings extra warmth, not necessarily drought. So down here, we could be having some more good weather. But it's an impact that... the other thing I meant to say is that the La Nina is often associated with colder winters in North America. And so there's a, you know, an interesting, could we see another cold winter in the Northern Hemisphere? And that leads me into the next thing that I wanted to draw attention to, which was a new paper that's just come out. It's in the Journal of the American Meteorological Society, and it's a paper by Samantha Stevenson and Baylor Fox Kemper. And they've looked at El Nino in model runs over the 21st century, trying to find out if you're going to get more El Ninos, more La Ninas, what's actually going to happen. And what they've found through running lots of model runs, is that the actual frequencies of El Nino and La Nina don't seem to change very much over the 21st century.
Right.
So it's not going to become tipped towards La Nina or El Nino, but that the fact that these weather patterns, these oceanic patterns, are influencing the weather, because the weather is influenced by it being warmer and generally wetter, that the weather events associated with those two particular patterns, El Nino and La Nina, will themselves become more intense. So we could see more severe droughts in the Western Pacific. We could see warmer, hotter,
summers in New Zealand during La Niñas, and vice versa for El Ninos. So it's an interesting thing that what we're seeing already is that the swing between El Nino and La Niña, the El Nino Southern Oscillation, as it's called, ENSO, because it's taking place in a warmer, wetter world, the events associated with them are getting worse.
And what the events last summer, say, for the cyclones in Queensland and the drought, as you say, in there in the Pacific Islands, they are potential examples of what it could be like.
Yeah, exactly. And the next item that I wanted to get onto it was jaw-dropping for me when I saw this piece, and I was surprised, in fact, that it hadn't been more widely covered, unless it was covered a lot while I was away, because it's dated August the 23rd, and where was I then? probably this. No. Anyway, if we can load up that page, Glenn, and stick it on screen, what you can see is that the NASA's satellites measuring sea level found that over 2010-11, over the Southern Hemisphere summer, the sea level dropped really quite considerably, as measured by satellite. Right. And another NASA satellite, the GRACE satellite, or satellites, which are the gravity mission, which they can use to measure the mass of the land underneath, and it's used to measure the mass of ice on Antarctica, for instance. It's where we get a lot of good data about what's happening to those ice sheets. What the GRACE mission discovered was that the oceans had given up so much water to the atmosphere, and that water actually fell in Brazil and Australia.
Huh.
And those events were so intense that they caused sea level to drop measurably.
Crikey.
And that, to me, is remarkable, you know? We knew it was wet in Queensland, and those floods were remarkable. But there was enough water going into that flooding in Australia, Brazil, and around the world to actually make sea level drop. And I found that was absolutely
mind-blowing. That's astounding.
I saw that piece. Yeah.
Some of this water dropping in Thailand at the moment. Right now we're seeing a third of Thailand underwater.
Right. That's right. And the it's an astonishing thing. Maybe what's going to happen is that sea level rise is not going to go as fast as we suspect it might in the near future, mainly because most of that water's evaporating and pouring onto land and causing lots of flooding. It's going to be extremely interesting to just see how this all develops.
Okay.
Really fascinating stuff.
But meanwhile, there are projections on sea level rise over the next 500 years.
Yes, that's right. And I'm just trying to get it up onto my screen so that I yeah, that it's a team in Denmark who have taken the way that sea levels performed over the last 100 years and used that to calibrate a model that allows them to predict how sea level will change according to different assumptions made about the extent to which we reduce our emissions. And the sort of middle parameters are suggesting that there would be a sea level rise of about 75 centimeters by the year 2100, and that by 2500 the sea will have risen by 2 meters. So the interesting point, and the point that they're making in their press release, is that, you know, sea level is not thinking about where sea level is going to be at the end of this century is not the final, you know, saying it's half a meter or a meter or whatever by 2100, actually the water's going to carry on rising for a very long time afterwards and won't begin to fall for, you know, a lot longer than that. So under their most pessimistic scenario, they're suggesting that sea levels will rise over a meter, 1.1 meters by the year 2100, and could have risen to as high as 5.5 meters by the year 2500. And that has, you know, if you're going to be, as we are in Canterbury, looking to rebuild Christchurch, which is a fairly low-lying city, the city planners need to think about, first of all, what are they building that in 50, 60, 70 years' time if over the 100 years beyond that, sea level is going to carry on rising and rising. I suspect that that sort of thinking isn't far enough advanced for the city planners to do more than kind of take it into account. I can't imagine anyone arguing that Christchurch should be rebuilt, you know, 20 metres above sea level.
No. Are there any examples?
But those sorts of questions are going to get...
Well, that's right. Those questions are going to be asked. Are there any examples in New Zealand at the moment where sea level rise is evident?
That's a difficult question, and I haven't done the research. But yes, I believe sea level is rising around New Zealand. It's a bit complex because New Zealand itself, bits of New Zealand are rising and bits are falling because we're, you know, tectonically very active. So what's happening at any individual place will depend to a greater or lesser extent on not only the way that sea level's behaving, but also the way that the land's behaving. But we've certainly got plenty of places that are very vulnerable. You've got the Auckland CBD, you've got Wellington CBD, you've got the Christchurch estuary. I believe the steps of the cathedral in Christchurch were only 5 meters above sea level, from memory. So, you know, by the year 2500, there could well be a beach in the middle of where the Christchurch Central Business District currently is.
Well, you looked at some of those scenarios in your Hot Topic book that came out a few years ago, didn't you?
Yeah, absolutely. We looked at it in some detail. There's a lot of work being done in this area now, and I'm hoping that, you know, over the next few months we'll learn more. Mm. But from a New Zealand perspective, we're probably able to cope with it. I know that Wellington has done some thinking about how they might cope with it. I know Nelson has done some thinking about how they might cope with it. I'm not sure what's happened in Auckland. Mm. But really, if we're looking at, as this team in Copenhagen is suggesting, somewhere between 75 centimetres or somewhere around 75 centimetres by the year 2100, that has enormous consequences for very large parts of the world. Mm. The one thing I did put in my book, and it was one of the key features of the 2007 fourth report, the IPCC's fourth report, was it's what they call the Asian mega deltas that will suffer in those circumstances, because they're already very low lying, and we've all seen dramatic pictures from Bangladesh of flooding there. The people there are adapting to move, you know, as islands move in their estuary, so they move with the islands. But there's going to be literally hundreds of millions of people made increasingly vulnerable by sea level that's increasing to that sort of level.
Yeah, indeed. All right, well, let's move on to the next story. And love them or hate them, Starbucks are a huge force in the world of coffee worldwide, and the way farmers are paid for their coffee, and I guess the way people drink coffee around the world as well. But they've also just lent their name, their force into highlighting some of the issues surrounding climate change. And they were speaking to The Guardian in this article, and they're concerned that world coffee supply is threatened by climate change. They told The Guardian, the sustainability director of Starbucks, told The Guardian that it said its farmers were already seeing the effects of a changing climate with severe hurricanes and more resistant bugs reducing crop yields. The company is now preparing for the possibility of a serious threat to global supplies. In his words, he said, "What we are really seeing as a company as we look 10, 20, 30 years down the road, if conditions continue as they are, is a potentially significant risk to our supply chain, which is the Arabica coffee bean." And it was the second warning in less than a month of a threat to a food item many people can't live without. What was the other one, of course, was chocolate.
yes. I mean, it's probably fair to say that, you know, coffee is so important to so many people, as indeed is chocolate, that those may be things that will make people realize that, you know, we are actually facing a major problem.
It'll probably take the effect on hops and beer for me to really, you know,
maybe. Or in my case, grapes.
Yes. Yeah.
But it's interesting. I mean, a crop like coffee is grown fairly widely around the world, but
has quite tight climatic tolerances. So as the climate changes in the places where coffee is currently grown, so they will have to adapt either by moving where they're growing it, or by adopting new techniques to try and mitigate the effect of any warming or rainfall changes or whatever. And then, of course, you've got this whole issue, as they drew attention to, of pests moving in, increasing storm damage and so on, all of which can make the difference between having a crop that's economically useful for the growers and of course for the buyers, and something that isn't.
But of course the cynic might say that Starbucks puts up their coffee by 50 cents and the spokesperson comes out and says, well, you know, it's because of climate change, you know, maybe, you know, that's the cynical sort of view. I mean, I'd imagine that that they are concerned about climate change and the effect on their farmers, but it could be spun that way, I suppose.
I think a certain cynicism is to be encouraged in this respect, because there is the phenomenon known as greenwash, and where corporations do their best to appear to be being friendly to the environment, taking climate change seriously, but actually aren't doing terribly much, or doing as little as they think they can get away with. Certain healthy cynicism to be encouraged, but nevertheless the problems that they're talking about are real. Whether we should believe them about how serious they may already be is of course another matter.
Indeed. All right, let's move on to a wee new climate science roundup that you have.
Yeah, it's Brian at Hot Topic blogged about this at the end of last week, and the World Resources Institute, which is a very well-respected organization in the US, has just produced a summary of the climate science of 2009 and 2010. So it's a kind of update on where we've got since the last IPCC report. It covers physical climate, the hydrological cycle, ecosystems, and climate change mitigation technologies and geoengineering and so on. So it's about 40-odd pages as a PDF. Not the sort of lightest of reading, but it does, you know, it covers a lot of bases. It pulls out a lot of important material. So, you know, it talks about the decrease in the amount of Arctic ice. It provides papers that, you know, to support all of its contentions. You know, it's just a very good overview of where we are today, and the direction, if you like, that the science is telling us that we're heading. So if you want to sort of quickly catch up with the state of the science, then I would say this is definitely a good read.
All right, check out that blog post that's just done on October the 17th. And now this next one has been out for a few weeks now, but it was while you were away, and I think it's really worth talking about, the new climate change atlas that NIWA in New Zealand has come out with.
Absolutely. It came out while I was away, as you say, and I didn't really have time at that time to go and look at it in any detail, but I had a look at it over the last week or so, and it's a really fascinating thing for a number of reasons. I mean, the first is that scientifically it's very interesting, because what they're doing is, if you like, mapping and providing a baseline for what we know about the oceans around New Zealand. So they're talking about the chemistry of the sea, the temperature of the sea, the way that the ocean currents and blocks of water move around off the coast of New Zealand. And they are, you know, first of all, they're pretty pictures, and I'm a sucker for good maps, and they're certainly that. So it's a fascinating look at what's happening at the moment. But it goes well beyond that, because what they're looking at, what will happen to this baseline information as the climate warming progresses. So some of the background to this is that they're expecting surface waters to warm and they'll become fresher, that's less salty. There'll be stratification, so the layers will become more defined, which may affect the flow of nutrients in the water. This will have impacts on the various forms of plankton content that you get in the water, which is obviously the base of the food chain for most sea life.
Yeah.
There's going to be less oxygen in certain areas. The warming of the water itself will have an influence on which species of creature live where together. And this baseline, this map, can then be projected forward. And they've done that in a number of instances to show how that will affect the important economic activities that we have on the oceans, because, you know, we have a very active fishing industry, and the exclusive economic zone of New Zealand is an important part of our economy. Mm. The other thing that interested me from a much more techie sort of point of view is that this information is actually going to go onto the web. So it's going to be a web-based atlas. So it's going to be a living archive, they say, supplemented with additional information. For example, on the distribution of species that have not previously been surveyed or mapped, or new experimental findings. So by making it, if you like, live inside a computer rather than just as a series of printed maps, it can grow with the subject. And you know, perhaps at some point we could get the NEWA guys on to talk about it, because I'm probably not doing it justice. But to me, I thought it was a fascinating way, because really, if you want to understand how things are changing, you've got to know what they're changing from, and then give yourself an idea about what they might change to. And this is a really interesting thing that NEWA have got stuck into.
Yeah. All right, well, that's basically all the news we have. Although, unless, Gareth, you wanted to touch on the oil disaster, the Rena ship that has run aground up north. I mean, it's not exactly climate-related in that, you know, that's only slightly climate-related, perhaps, in that there's oil on board and it's leaking out. But there might be some interest, perhaps, around the world with what's going on there.
Yeah, one of the things that struck me particularly was that New Zealand is a very small country, and it doesn't have particularly good local equipment available for capturing oil spills. So to some extent, the speed with which the authorities were able to move to deal with this crisis were limited by, you know, when they could get gear into the country, or when they could get it to the Astrolabe Reef and the Rena to get it to work. Mm. And the implication is that, you know, the current government is trying to encourage oil companies to drill offshore New Zealand, really just about everywhere, but in particular off the east coast of the North Island, the northern east coast around Gisborne. And there was a lot of protest activity about that late last summer. If we can't cope with a few hundred tons of fuel oil leaking from a container ship, how on earth are we going to cope with something like the terrible BP thing in the Gulf of Mexico last year? I mean, the mind sort of boggles that, you know, we would simply be unable to deal with it, and it could be a horrible disaster.
So indirectly, this disaster has implications for New Zealand's future carbon emissions. If we're not going to go drilling because we can't deal with a spill, then I guess that has positive effects on our future as a oil nation and emitting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere.
Yeah, well, I've have noticed over the time that I was away, it does seem that the government has set its sights on a fossil fuel future. Seems to be encouraging this oil exploration, and it seems to be encouraging fracking for shale gas around New Zealand, certainly exploring for it, which I find a little bit concerning, as it sort of locks us into an infrastructure that I don't think would make sense, knowing what we know about where the world is actually going. Mm. But we have, and I'm sure we'll cover this in a future show, but we're heading in towards a general election in New Zealand. So the politics of policy on climate change down here are going to be at least referred to. I'm not sure that they're going to be a major part of any election campaign by any party except possibly the Green Party. But it will be interesting to see how it all pans out. And I suspect that the oil lapping onto the beaches of the northern North Island will actually make the government perhaps a little bit more receptive to the idea that they need to be considering the downsides of a fossil fuel future, not just going for the money.
That's right. Certainly a powerful image anyway. Well, very shortly, we're going to be talking about ocean cooling in the Debunking the Skeptics segment with John Cook at skepticalscience.com. But first of all, I do want to thank some of our partners, our media partners, help us get the show and the word out there. Scoop.co.nz and idealog.co.nz in the Idealog Sustain section there. Thanks very much to both of those organisations. And also where you can also download the show onto your smartphone, that being through Stitcher.com and the app for iPhone and Android and other devices as well. Where you can also listen to a whole bunch of other shows from various organisations around the world. It's quite a cool thing to do, so check that out, Stitcher.com. So let's bring John Cook on from Skeptical Science, debunking the skeptic, as he does so well, joining us in Brisbane, Australia. Welcome back to the show, John.
G'day, Graham. How are you going?
Very well, thank you. And, of course, it's been so long since the three of us have been back together. Gareth as well, who's at the concert.
It's been months, Gareth, since we've talked.
Well, John, many thanks for filling in for me so well. And because I know that you're a shy and modest and retiring sort of chap, I would like just to draw the attention of the world, the wide world, to the fact that last month you were awarded the Australian Museum's Eureka Prize for the advancement of climate change knowledge. And I can't imagine anyone more deserving of it.
Yay.
Well done.
If we had a canned crowd in here, they'd be going...
Technically, it was Skeptical Science that won, and it was a team effort because there's a lot of people who've contributed to Skeptical Science. So
you've had to send a case of wine to Dana, have you?
Well, we're all going to meet up in December in San Francisco, so hopefully I can buy everyone a beer when I get over there.
Oh, well, that'd be fantastic. That sounds like it could be one of the AGU highlights.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. It's going to be a great night.
And, of course, we won't mention the rugby on the weekend, or have we just mentioned it, eh?
I don't follow rugby. That's one of the sports I take interest in.
Yes.
I should just say, as a man with Welsh heritage, that there is still one very important game to go, which will take place at the end of this week, when Wales will play Australia to decide who is the third best team in the world.
Yeah, well, we're probably going to get hammered in that game as well. So.
No, that's my line. That's my line.
Yeah, you stole it. Anyway, let's move on, because we're talking about ocean cooling is the skeptical argument today. Is this one of the top 10 arguments? It is, isn't it?
No, it's not, but it's it's topical because I'd say it'd probably be about top 20 or so.
Yeah.
But it's quite topical because there's been some papers that have come out and a bit of some measurements have come out which have just shed light on this subject, so I thought it would be a good one for today.
Okay, all right, let's dive on into it. So what is the argument that people bring about ocean cooling?
Well, the argument, I guess, is that that as most of global warming is going into the oceans, about 90% of the heat that our planet is building up is accumulating in the ocean. So if the ocean wasn't warming, that would show a sign. That would be a sign that global warming isn't happening. But what we actually observe when we add up all the heat building up in the oceans, and also add to that the heat building up that's warming the land and the atmosphere and melting the ice, then what we actually find is our planet is still building up heat. And hopefully you can bring up a graph that I've posted on Skeptical Science over the last week, which shows that's the total amount of heat that our planet is building up, or the change in heat since 1962. And for people who say that global warming stopped in 1998 or it hasn't warmed over the last 10 years, this shows that that's completely untrue, because over the last 10 years it's continued to build up heat. And in fact, it's building up heat at a rate of something like 2.5 Hiroshima bombs per second. It's
crikey.
It's a lot of heat.
Yeah.
So, okay. You
can
hear.
Can you tell me what that is? Sorry, John. Can you tell me what that is in Scoville units, please? Scoville is how you measure the heat of a chili.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I'll do the conversions and get back to you. And unfortunately, I can't. I don't have any Aussie icons that I can measure that by either. Usually, everything's in Sydney harbours, but I'll have to work out some Australian icon to measure heat by as well. I'll get back to you on that as well.
What's her name? Al McPherson. What? How would this rate to Al? Next to Al McPherson. Yeah.
So I think we're accumulating heat at a rate of 10,000 L's per year.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a very impressive graph. That it's one of the. This is the latest version of one that you've had on the site for a while, I know, and it is really impressive because it shows that the amount of heating we're getting that we can observe in the atmosphere is only a tiny proportion of the total amount of heat that's accumulating in the system.
Yeah, that's right. It's all going, almost all going into the ocean, and ocean scientists like to say that it's not global warming, it's ocean warming. But then every scientist thinks that their particular field is the most important field of science. So
we had an interesting story a little bit earlier on, and Gareth knows more about this, but that most of that ocean ended up on Queensland last summer. Well, not exactly, but isn't that right, Gareth?
Yeah, that's right. It was two sets of satellite observations. The first, the ones that measure sea level, showed a drop-off, quite a significant downturn over the austral summer, so over Christmas last year and into the beginning of this year. And then the GRACE satellite, the gravity mission, detected that most of this water ended up over Australia and Brazil. So it just blew me away that the amount of water that fell on Queensland and on South America was sufficient to make sea level actually fall. I thought that was just an incredible thing to be aware of.
Yeah, that's quite incredible, isn't it? That global sea level actually fell because of so much rain happening over land. And it is weird that sea level dropped quite sharply in 2010, but I guess if I was wondering where it was, it was actually flowing past the next suburb and drowning Queensland houses.
Yeah, that's where it ended up. We've got another graph on screen at the moment, global ocean heat content.
Yeah, so this one's a really interesting one because what this shows is the amount of heat accumulating in the oceans. The red line here shows how much heat is accumulating in the upper ocean, the top 700 metres, while the black line shows heat accumulating much deeper, down to 2 kilometres deep. Now, when people say that the oceans are cooling, usually they refer to the upper ocean, and that's the red line in this graph. And what you see in this graph is that around 2003, the level of ocean warming actually does tend to drop off. But the reason why is because heat is being exchanged between the upper ocean and the deeper water. Right. So heat is actually getting moved down to the deeper water. And we see that because the black line, the total ocean heat, has continued to warm past 2003. So this period where people say the oceans are cooling, the oceans are still building up heat. It's just it's going deeper.
Okay, and moving on to the next graph that shows upper Pacific Ocean circulation during hiatus decades.
Yeah, so a paper came out just recently by Gerald Meal, and it explains what's happening, because I've been quite interested in this has been an issue that climate wonks have been discussing for the last couple of years is where is this heat going and why and what's changed. And so what seems to be happening is this is a result of ocean cycles, where we see this every year, like with El Nino, where where it's in the El Nino stage, the surface temperatures get a lot warmer and there's a lot more heat in the upper ocean. And then when you get La Nina stages, all this cold water comes from the deep up to the top of the surface. And so there's an exchange, cold water coming up and hot air getting pushed down into the deep ocean. And basically what this latest research by Neil found was that even when you have a long-term global warming trend, which is what we have now, you still get these periods, these hiatus periods of around even a decade where the surface trend can slow down.
Right.
And what's happening is ocean cycles are taking heat down to the deep ocean and bringing cool water up to the surface.
And so where are we at the moment?
I guess we're towards the end of a decade one of these hiatus periods. And it seems like while the surface warming trend has slowed down over the last decade, the heat has still been building up in the deep ocean. So our planet is still building up heat. We know that from ocean measurements. We know that from satellite measurements, which measure the sunlight coming in and the heat escaping back out to space. We know that the planet is building up heat. The question is, where is it going?
Mm.
And what these measurements show is that it's going into the deep ocean.
Which is pretty much what everybody guessed, because there is nowhere else for it to go apart from melting ice. And when you do the numbers on melting ice, you work out that doesn't account for or missing heat that Kevin Trenberth talked about.
Mm.
And the only place for it to go is into the deep ocean. So what's interesting about the Meal paper is that it gives us a very clear idea of where and how and the scale of things. It gives us the first sort of really good numbers for what may be going on.
Yeah, it explains what's happening or how it's happening, and then also recent measurements that have been finding the heat building up in the deep ocean have also confirmed that the deep ocean is warming. And also it's important to note that the graph I showed you there was only going down to 2,000 metres deep, but obviously the ocean goes a lot deeper than that. And while there aren't that much measurements of the abyssal depths, the measurements that we do have do indicate that there's significant heating, there's significant heat building up right at the bottom of the ocean. And I read another paper. In fact, it was a paper by some Australian scientists, which is where I got the data for that first graph from, with the blue ocean and the red land warming. And what they find is at the very bottom of the ocean, the abyssal depths below 3,000 metres, there's about 16% of ocean warming is happening at the abyssal depths.
Hmm.
So that's a significant amount of warming, or a significant amount of heat is building up right at the below 3,000 metres. And one final point too. I think it's interesting that even though we've had this ocean cycle, which has damped down the warming trend, and there are also two other effects that have caused a slowdown in warming, and that's there's a lot of aerosols coming from China going up into the atmosphere, and that has a cooling effect. Mm. And there's a third of which have. Oh, that's right. And there's also the fact that the sun has actually been a lot cooler I think it's at its coolest level in over 100 years at the moment. And despite these three effects with the ocean cooling and the solar cooling and the aerosol cooling, the planet is still building up heat. And we still had our hottest year on record in 2010.
Yeah. Very good point. Well, of course, there is a short URL code to all of this, and I know that Gareth has been looking forward over the past couple of months to getting back to this.
Yeah, we've missed it too. I think we read the URLs, but it just wasn't the same.
No, it wasn't. So off you go, Gareth.
Okay, well, the short code for the ocean heat is http://sks. bit.to/oceanheat.
Yes, that is it. Thanks very much, John Cook, and lovely to see you again. And we will catch up once again, of course, in the next couple of weeks or so. Congratulations once again for that fantastic award as well.
Thanks, Glenn, and good to have you back, Gareth. So hopefully we'll be more regular now, right?
I'm just jealous that you're going to get to go to the AGU.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Sorry, Matt.
Okay, thanks, John.
Thanks, John.
See ya.
And before we move on, I do want to thank another one of our media partners. It is sciblogs.co.nz, who have also been posting the show for us up there. It's a great community of science bloggers from all over New Zealand, and often very candid blogs and reactions to some of the latest science news, but also really interesting research as well. It's well worth checking out. sciblogs.co.nz. Right now we're into the solutions segment, all the kind of stuff that might help us out in a low-carbon future. And the first story got my interest that Gareth put in there, because it shows that we may in fact be better at something else other than just rugby. We've entered something called the Solar Decathlon. Gareth, tell us about that.
Yes, it's... A New Zealand team finished from Victoria University of Wellington finished third in this US competition. And basically it's for teams of university students, college students, to design and build solar powered homes. And they've got to be cost effective, energy efficient and attractive. Hmm. And what I liked about this story was first of all, that there was a New Zealand team doing so well in a major US competition. So, you know, we were right up there. But what I loved about it was that, I'll forgive myself in advance for lapsing into broad Kiwi, but they're actually designed the Kiwi Batch of tomorrow. Now, a batch, for those who don't know, is a holiday home. And traditionally, these are, you know, they were kind of just built on a beach somewhere, and they might be the equivalent of a sort of wooden hut on a beach. And over the years, they, you know, families add to them, and they become sprawling and everything else. In the last 15 years, they've tended to become vast architect-designed mansions, particularly around Auckland. But this team at VUW have taken the idea of a Kiwi Batch, which is somewhere where extended families go for summer breaks by the seaside, mostly, and they've interpreted it as a modern solar-powered, energy-efficient building, and they've done it so well that they finished third in this competition. And I just thought that was brilliant. Great.
Was that the one that for New Zealand listeners and viewers, they might remember it was a news story, and it was down in Wellington, I think somewhere near the Beehive or somewhere in central Wellington. They put it on display for a while?
Yep, absolutely right. They put it in central Wellington to demonstrate what it could do before they then packed it up and took it over to the US.
Is that the one we're looking at on screen at the moment?
Yep, the first lighthouse, it's called. Not it.
Okay.
If you click on the second link on the show notes, it'll take you to the page that's got pictures of actual batch.
There we go. Okay. Yeah. Oh, it's really nice, isn't it? And really functional. I mean, this would be a batch you would happily not just holiday in, but live in.
No, that's right. I mean, I like to think that I am a writer, and every writer wants to have a writer's retreat somewhere. Mm. And I used to think that I've always taken with the remote parts of the northern west coast of the South Island of New Zealand, as an absolutely stunning part of the world. But there aren't there very many places with nice homes. I mean, there are homes and there are nice ones, but they're not always the same thing in the right places. Yeah. I just thought it'd be really lovely to have a sort of pre-designed batch, energy efficient, you could just drop in to a site. And these guys at VUW have gone ahead and shown how it can be done. It just looks absolutely wonderful.
Are you?
I want one. Please.
I want one. Yeah. Are you telling me though that as a South Islander, you still call them batches and not cribs?
Cribs are the south of the South Island. So when you get down to Otago and Southland, they become cribs. But up here in the rarefied heights of Canterbury and up north around Nelson, they're all batches, I'm afraid.
They're weirdos down south.
They roll their R's.
That's right. They're from another planet. Moving on, though. A skyscraping tower will power 100,000 homes with hot air. What's this?
Okay, well, if you can put the thing on screen, you'll it's a huge tower, which is 2,600 feet high, so like a giant chimney, if you like, and it's surrounded by a like a glass house, if you like a solar gatherer. So basically, the air gets hot underneath the glass house around this chimney, flows towards the chimney, and then as it goes up the chimney, because it's hot and therefore light and buoyant, wants to go up, it drives turbines. And this particular plan for the Arizona desert, it would be the world's second tallest structure, but would be generate enough power to cope with 100,000 homes.
Wow.
They call it a solar updraft tower, and it would be able to produce 200 megawatts of electricity each day, and it will be able to produce power at night as well, because the ground will still be hot and still heat air to flow it up, so it doesn't need any water. And it's quite expensive. It'll cost $750 million to build it, but they think that the operating cost, and yeah, it should be interesting and to do. The there were plans to do something similar in Australia, and I have no idea what's happened to those. But it's just, if you happen to have a desert nearby, then this seems to be an interesting concept. Anyway,
could be useful in Australia, perhaps.
Yeah, Australia, yeah. Africa.
Yeah.
Yeah, anywhere where you've got enough heat to be able to drive one of these things.
Tuvalu, perhaps, seeing as Tuvalu's turning into sort of part water world, part
of this is probably bigger than the entire land area of Tuvalu.
That's true. All right. yeah, moving right along onto the next story. NASA is issuing an award in a green aviation competition. What's all this about, Gareth?
Yeah, well, it's a reasonable prize, $1.35 million, and they awarded it to basically there was a competition to find fuel efficient aircraft and to help to spark an electric aeroplane industry, and the rules were that the winning aircraft had to fly 200 miles in less than 2 hours and use less than 1 gallon of fuel per occupant, or the equivalent in electricity. And they had 14 teams enter, and the first two teams were both electrically powered. They both achieved twice the fuel efficiency requirement, and they flew 200 miles using just over half a gallon of fuel equivalent per passenger.
What's that in litres? Do you know?
Hang on, US gallons against imperial gallons
Google it again. Gallon, litre. Google will know.
They flew 200 miles at 100 miles per hour.
One US gallon is 3.7 litres.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they're doing it on 1.85 litres of per passenger per hour. But they were doing this with electricity, so there was no liquid fuel involved. So they were able to basically prove that an electric aeroplane could be a lot more than just a toy. So really interesting, and it's a very pretty looking plane, the one that won, the Pipistrel.
Well, it looks like a glider, doesn't it?
It does, yes, and I mean that makes sense, because you want the plane's got to be fairly light, it's got to have plenty of lift, because you're going to be packing it with batteries and, of course, a couple of people. So, I just thought this was interesting because we've done a number of items in the past about electric airplanes, but this was a particularly interesting one and one to watch, I guess.
It won't compete against Boeings or Airbuses just yet.
No, and it certainly won't be competing against the A380 or whatever it was that I spent half a day inside, locked away somewhere. Anyway, might be a lot more pleasant to fly in, though.
I did hear, talking about that, I don't have the story link here or anything, but Richard Branson was further down the road of using biofuels on Virgin jets.
I did see something about that. Yes, he's certainly pumping some money into that. I also saw on the news today that he is planning to open a spaceport in the USA because he's, as you know, Virgin Galactic intends to take people up to the space.
Yeah.
Interesting thing.
Indeed. All right. Well, let's stay with electrics on the next story. This one, talking about the electric car infrastructure in the UK. They are starting to roll it out with public and private charging networks all over the show. After the launches of a Boris-backed recharging network in London, 216 points, in fact, and a so-called national network from Electro City, 12 of those this year, Chargemaster on Wednesday opened what it described as the UK's first privately funded nationwide electric vehicle network, around 150. So that's on top of all those other ones I just said. These new additions join the UK's hundreds of existing public points designed to elevate the chicken and egg problem for electric cars that people have been talking about. Also range anxiety as well, where people think, oh no, I'm not going to be able to reach my destination before I run out. Chargemaster's new network, Polar, all these kind of names that they come out with these things, should go some way to reduce all the fears that people have had. It says it'll have 4,000 points by the end of next year, built at the rate of around 300 a month with its partners. What doesn't look so good, according to The Guardian, and is so often used as a selling point for electric cars, is the money side. Membership of Polar works out at £24.50 a month, and you pay 90p per charge. That seems steep, as he says, but is that steep, I mean, compared to petrol?
Considering I spent a chunk of September in the UK and we did drive around, and yes, that is remarkably cheap compared to the cost of petrol in Britain. I think that they're just comparing the two things and saying one costs more than the other. But if you stack electric cars up against the cost of motoring in the UK, in conventional vehicles, it's going to be a lot cheaper. What really struck me, though, in driving 3,600 kilometres across Europe and then a bit further in Britain, was the number of small cars that you see on the roads. There were a lot of the little Mercedes smart cars, the BMW 1 Series and the Mini that they're based on, and they're everywhere. I was really sort of struck that the larger cars were certainly compared with the last time I drove around Europe, which is 6 or 7 years ago, you didn't see so many large cars on the roads. And it just proved to me that having small, very fuel-efficient cars is just as important a response to reducing fossil fuel usage and carbon emissions as trying to jump straight to electric cars. I mean, I think electric cars are a very important part of any solution, but so are very fuel-efficient vehicles.
And just to add to this, I was fortunate enough the other weekend to try one of these hybrid vehicles. I'd always been interested in having a look at them, and my own experience of a hybrid vehicle was sort of in the back of a taxi and sort of hearing how silent they are and the flashy dials and what not up front. But I was given the opportunity by Honda New Zealand. I should say that they haven't paid me to say or anything like this, but they did offer the car for the weekends that I could drive around. And we ended up heading up north from Auckland up to a place called Tutukaka for the weekend. And I'm only new to actually driving a car. I've been driving a scooter for many years now, but just recently gotten behind the wheel and had a really great experience. It was their Insight car, which is a petrol engine but electric assist, which I think is quite different to the Toyota the Toyota Prius. Which is the opposite. But I found it a really nice, quiet car, but also all the feedback that the dash was giving you was just really interesting about when it was recharging the battery and when the battery was assisting with the drive, and but also made you drive more efficiently because the dash would light up different colours. It would be green when you were most efficient and blue when you were being inefficient, you know, when you were climbing up a hill and putting your foot on the gas. And I found that was quite a cool way to make people think about how they're driving, not only, of course, what they're driving, but how they're driving and how much petrol is going out the back. And at the end of the journey, back to Auckland, from Tutukaka to Auckland, we used 5.3 litres per 100 kilometres, which is not bad, I suppose. I think they had a whole bunch of other people doing it as well, and I think 4.3 was the best that someone got, and 7.1 was the least efficient. But yeah, I thought that was a good experience the other weekend anyway. And that was my experience.
No, that's great.
Yeah, driving a hybrid.
To give you an example from the other side of the coin, we've got a little Peugeot diesel. We've got a 308, and we've had it for 3.5 years now, I guess. We regularly get 800 kilometers of range out of a $60 tank full of diesel. Now, you've got to put the New Zealand's kind of road user charges for diesel on top of that, but it still works out at something under 5 liters per 100 kilometers, something like that, which is quite remarkable.
It's pretty good
fuel efficiency.
Yeah,
and the car, it's from a driver's perspective, it's a nice little car, plenty of power. Mm. So the Europeans did for many years specialize in producing highly fuel efficient diesels, and that's put the particularly the French and German manufacturers into a very strong position with those sorts of engines.
Indeed. Well, that's been a great show, but I think we've come to the end just as your connection is starting to fall apart, so I think it's probably a good time for us to finish the show. But it's been great having you back, Gareth.
It's good to be back, and it's good to be slowly getting switched on. And if Mr. Telecom, Chorus or Extra are listening, could you please pay attention to my broadband connection, because I'm getting very cross with it at the moment.
Exactly.
Anyway, good to speak to you, Glenn, and very good to catch up with John again, and looking forward to the next show. We've got a few things planned. Definitely, I want to do a roundup on the Arctic, and we're hoping to get a special guest to help us with that. Plus, of course, we're getting towards the summer in New Zealand, and lots of things to talk about.
Indeed. Well, in the meantime, make sure you check out the website, theclimateshow.com and hot-topic.co.nz. So anything that we've been talking about today and you think, I want to follow that up, then you'll find all that stuff in the show notes, as well as the links to be able to subscribe to the audio version or check out the video version as well if you like it visual, and the links to get it down onto your smartphone or mobile device as well. Also, facebook.com/theclimateshow and twitter.com/theclimateshow. Love to have you following and talking over there as well. Make yourself known. And glenwilliams.co.nz for me, and Gareth's over there at hot-topic.co.nz. Gareth, until next time, which won't be as long as the last time.
I certainly hope not.
We'll see you
soon.
Bye.
Cheers. What?